Well, good morning, church.
Good morning.
This is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Amen?
Amen.
I want to welcome you all to our traditional service here at the Green Street campus of Cornerstone First Global Methodist Church. We are so thrilled to have you all here with us this morning. I want to give you some announcements within the life of the church for this upcoming week and this upcoming month. And I want to start with a particularly exciting announcement that Dave Upton, our SPRC committee chair, is going to share with us. So, Dave?
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm going to start by telling y'all a story of what happened to me on the way to church this morning. I'm driving down 63 headed to town, and early because I have to speak at the Arbor service this morning, and was going to get there a little bit early, so I'm headed in, and right as I cross the Elkhatchie Bridge, I see blue lights coming toward me, and I went, I don't see anything he's chasing. Sure enough, he spun around, and I pulled over, and he came up to my window, and I had my license and everything ready for him, and he said, you know why I stopped you? I said, I think I do. He said, I hope Lana's not watching. She's at home with the grandkids right now. I'm going to try to keep this a secret if I can. He said, you look like you're dressed to go to church. I said, I am. He said, what time does church start? I said, 9 o'clock. He said, well, why are you in such a hurry? I said, I guess I was just excited to get there. And I'm always excited to get to church, but I'm particularly excited to be at church this morning because I have some truly good news to share with you. I'm here representing the Staff Parish Relations Committee. We have a great committee, spent a lot of time and effort in over the past few weeks at trying to come to a decision on pastoral leadership for the new Cornerstone Church. And we understood what an awesome responsibility it was to ensure we got the right kind of pastoral leadership to take advantage of the energy and momentum and enthusiasm that's in the church right now. So the first order of business we had is that we wanted to, if Matthew wanted to become a part of the global church, we wanted him to stay. And when he indicated that was his intention, the first piece of the puzzle was in place. And we couldn't be happier to have Matthew with us. And you know, you've heard from Matthew a lot over the past few years. And let me also say that over the transition period, which was, you know, necessary but a difficult time in many ways, Matthew stood in the breach, handled a lot of difficult situations, and did it with a smile on his face and a heart for God. And we're just so glad to have him with us and appreciate him. He's invested in us, and we're invested in him. And he, as I said, he's done a great job. But we knew he also was going to need some help because we have a bold vision for this church where we'd like to see it go and grow over time. And as we set out to try to find some help for Matthew in that regard, we began discussions with Alan Beasley, who is with the North Georgia, or the North Georgia, shows my old heritage, the North Alabama Conference of the Global Methodist Church. And he was here, the gentleman that was here during the church conference. And we began to talk to him about the need for a pastor. And he let us know real quickly as a committee that this would be a very desirable church for many pastors. And he thought he would have no difficulty at all finding a very good pastor for us. And so we began to discuss have those discussions and talk about the kind of things that we thought we were looking for. But all the while, God was working in the background. Somebody had mentioned to me that that Billy Colvin might be interested in trying to find some way to help us in this transition. So I called Billy, and Billy said he'd love to sit down and talk with me, and we met at Who's Diner. What a better place to try to solve a big problem, right? So we met at Who's Diner. We had several meetings there over the coming few weeks, and the longer we talked, the more I think it became obvious to Billy and to me and the committee that the answer to our problem was right in front of us. God does work in mysterious ways, and we could just feel that we had an exceptional opportunity for our church. Let me also say just for a minute, because I think it's always important to feel like that we are part of something that is good, And I would tell you that in all of our work with the Global Methodist Church through this last month and our dealings with them, what a pleasure to work with. They've been responsive. They have had a great heart. And there's been no bureaucracy. Whatever we needed their assistance in, they've made it very easy to do, and we're very pleased for that. So Billy and Matthew have been meeting and working diligently over the last few weeks and talking about how they'll work together. Billy will tell you a little bit about this shortly. They're both going to be able to preach at both services on a regular basis. So if you want to, if you just get where you can't stand to miss one of their sermons, you can go back and forth and hear them both places. Or if you want to stay in your congregation where you worship, you'll be able to see them both because they're going to be moving back and forth. But when they met with the SPRC, we just could not have been more pleased with their enthusiasm, their energy, and their passion for the path in front of us. And we just think we've got a wonderful situation here for our church. Most of you know Billy. For those of you who don't know him as well, he brings a rich set of experiences that I think will be very, very valuable in this role. Billy has been a school administrator, a football coach. He's been the school superintendent in Coleman County. All of those leadership responsibilities, administrative responsibilities will be very helpful. But the most important thing is Billy's evangelism, his heart for God, and just what a wonderful, kind man he is. And I can't think of anybody who is better to work alongside, yoked up, shoulder to shoulder with Matthew to lead this congregation forward into the future. So please give me a big, warm Cornerstone welcome to our new co-pastor, Billy Coleman.
Well, Billy, I know you have plenty of words to share later in our order of worship this morning, but would you like to share a few words in light of the announcement?
Sure. Would somebody help me dress on Sunday? First thing I'd like to say is what an honor and privilege it is to work with this guy. And put me down for loving Matthew. Can't wait to work with him, alongside him. That's a tremendous blessing. What really, and I know you're going to hear from me a little bit later, so I think for me personally, I've stood up before you and said thank you a lot lately. I've been saying thank you to a lot of people. I spoke at a youth rally up in North Alabama, and I did a lot of thank yous for what you have meant to our family, for your prayers and your support during difficult times for us. I've prayed that somehow I could do something more than just say it, that I would have the opportunity. I prayed for the opportunity to serve and to be able to show you where I am and what I'd like to do. And I just want you to know God answered my prayer, and I give thanks to Him. And I pray that everything is done for the glory of God, and it's a blessing to work with Matthew. And I'm kind of a, you know, we're a little different. But Matthew's really young, and I'm not so young, you know. But we're going to be working together. But from an old football coach, let me put it this way, I'm fixing to work my tail off. I love this church, and I thank you, and I thank the committee for the opportunity. Thank you. Thank you.
Well, I don't have any other announcements to beat that, but we've still got a few more to go through with our list this morning. If you haven't already, please make sure you sign in on the attendance pads at the end of your pews. That way we can stay in communication with you, connected with you as part of the body of Christ. If you would do that for us, we would greatly, greatly appreciate it. We are still in the process of collecting sanitation items to take to teachers and those who are on the front lines during these next couple of sickly months. So if you'd like to drop off paper towels, Kleenex, tissues, Lysol spray, hand sanitizer, we'll gladly take all of it and distribute it where it needs to go. So at the entrance to both of our locations on Sunday mornings, we've got giant blue bins where you can deposit those items and we will get them to the places where they need to go. Now, I have one announcement that was laid on the pulpit this morning, so I better make sure to read it. The church would like to thank everyone for their patience during this time while we establish our new phone systems and website communications. If you signed up for church communications and have not received anything, please check your email settings and spam or junk files and allow or trust the website server. Our new phone system is in progress, and you may see it as a Huntsville number. That is where it is routed through Spectrum, and it is not a long-distance call. So thank you and God bless. That's from our tech folks who have been working diligently to get our communications online. So if you're still looking to subscribe to that, if you haven't already, or you're just joining us this Sunday and you'd like to learn more information, you can go to our website, which is cornerstone-fgmc.org. When you go to that website, there will be a button you can click that says subscribe. You can plug in your pertinent name, email address, where you'd like communication to be sent to you, and you will receive it in your inboxes. So that is an opportunity that's available to you. Any sort of communication that needs to go out to the church will go out through that communication. So if you're interested in learning more, that's the way to go about doing it. We're going to be having a wonderful event that's planned on March 5th over at the Arbor. Now, there's a particular fellow that the youth absolutely adore by the name of DeMac. And DeMac's going to come and perform, I believe it, either 5 o'clock or 6 o'clock on March 5th. Now, before that event takes place, we're going to have a wild game cook-off. So if you think similar to the past where we've had the tailgating party and things of that sort, it'll just be a way for us to kind of come together, fellowship, and have a good meal and good fellowship time. So if you'd like to participate in that or compete in it, I think they've got two different categories, one for maybe bird and one for fish. Now, if you want more information or you'd like to sign up with the team, get in touch with BJ Barnett or David Hand, and they will get you registered, set, and good to go. We are receiving giving through multiple different avenues for your tithes and offerings. Of course, we pass around the collection plate as we sing the doxology on Sunday mornings. But if you are like me and you walk out the door on Sunday and you forget your checkbook, we got other options available to you. We've got a text to give where you can find that phone number listed in your order of worship this morning. We've also got the church website. There's an option where you can go and you can click on it and give through that, and it connects to a portal for ACH. Now, if you would like to give through ACH Giving, you can reach out to the church office, contact Jeb Blankenship. She's got forms that you can fill out to submit for that and have that set where you can just withdraw out of your bank account without you even thinking of it. So there are multiple different ways for you to give. And if you got any questions, we'd be more than happy to give you more information with any of those options. Ash Wednesday is coming up this Wednesday. So we are partnering with other churches that are within our new denomination, the Global Methodist Church, in this area to set up drive-by stations where you can come and drive through and receive the imposition of ashes. Now, our church is going to be set up at Cazadores from 7 to 8 o'clock in the morning on Wednesday. There will be other places where other Global Methodist churches will be set up. I don't have the full list of those yet. When we get that full list, we will email that out to you so that if there's one that's a little bit closer to where you work or where you're maybe going to grab breakfast in the morning, you can swing by one of those places and receive just the same remembrance that we are dust, and to dust we shall return. That's one way where we would love to worship fellowship with you on Wednesday morning. Church office is going to be closed tomorrow in memoriam of President's Day. So if you need us, we're not going to be there. But you can reach us through our cell phone, shoot an email. We'll be back in the office on Tuesday to respond to whatever concerns, questions, comments you may have. One final point of business. We've got a sheet up here as we have the last couple weeks. We recognize that folks who wanted to transfer their membership may not have been able to make it on Celebration Sunday or last Sunday. So if you are a current member of First United Methodist Church and you would like to transfer your membership to Cornerstone, then during our invitation hymn, you are welcome to come up, sign this piece of paper, and we will send it on to FUMC as well as keep it in our church records, and that process will be done. Now, if your signature is like mine and it's illegible, you can't read my signature, please make sure that you print your name off to the side. That helps us with our record keeping and knowing who it is that signed that piece of paper. So that's going to be available to you again as we do our invitation hymn. If you're not a member of FUMC, if you're wanting to consider transferring from a different church or join by profession of faith, please give us a call at the church office. I'd love to sit down with you. Billy would love to sit down with you. We'd love to just kind of talk with you and set up a day and time where you can make the vows of membership before the congregation on a Sunday morning. Whew, about feel like preaching. All right, those are all my announcements for this morning. So as we prepare our hearts for worship, let's go to our Lord together in prayer. Almighty and eternal God, you who have created and sustain all things by your word, that same word who took on flesh, who came to dwell among us and died to save sinners. We draw near to you this morning because you are infinitely worthy of our worship. You are greatly worthy to be praised. You've caused your grace, like rain, to fall upon the heads of the just and the unjust. You make your mercies new before us each and every day. And it is in the death and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, by the witness of the Holy Spirit who dwells within us, to the glory of our Heavenly Father, that we who believe by grace through faith have now received light and life, abundantly and eternally, here, now, and forevermore. It is because of that precious gift of grace that we come together this morning as one people, as your body, your church, to worship you in the fullness of spirit and truth here in this hour. Lord, we pray that you would pour out your spirit on all of us who are gathered here, in person and online, that you would not only be the object of our worship here this morning, but the very power and very authority by which we worship, that our worship may be to your glory and for the good of your church. Lord, we love you, we trust you, we lift up this time to you and entrust the fruit of it into your care. In Christ's name, amen.
Join us as we sing O Worship the King. It can be found in your hymnal on page 73. We will sing all five verses.
Please remain standing for Apostles' Creed, number 881 in your hymnal. Let us rejoice in this confession of the Christian faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth,
and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord,
who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Now, if you would, please greet each other.
Good morning.
Good morning. So far, so good. Like you're having a good time. Be seated, please. Let us pray. Dear Father God, we praise you for all the blessings you've given us. We are so unworthy. But we do pray that as we take those blessings into our life, that we can show our thanks by the way that we live our life. Be your witness in the world. We lift up to you those that need your healing touch, physically and spiritually. We lift up to you a country founded upon your principles, your beliefs. We're thankful for those leaders that pass this on to us and would only ask that you strengthen us to be the legacy that would pass to this next generation those same principles. As our leaders make decisions, we ask that they would turn to you for guidance. We're thankful for the church today, worldwide, that as your truth is proclaimed, it will be proclaimed into the hearts of those believers who are listening and want to live the truth in their life every day. As wonderful as it is to be here today in this church, help us to realize that we're part of a much, much bigger church that lives within the hearts of all those who believe. Father, thank you for our families. The opportunity we have as parents and grandparents to set the example and pass the truth on to our young people. But of all these things, most of all, thank you for the opportunity to know you through Jesus Christ, who loved us enough that he died on a cross for us so that we could be forgiven and free, so that we know that we're never alone. No matter how dark it gets, there's light. No matter how the mountain is, there's strength to climb it. All because you live in us through your Son. Forgive us of our sins. For we prayed in the name of him who taught us to say when we pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever.
Amen.
Will you all stand and join us again as we sing Closer to Thee, hymn number 407, and we'll sing all three verses. Thank you.
Be seated, please. Now, if our ushers would come forward, we'll worship with our tithes and our offering. Let's pray. Dear Father God, we would never pretend to think that our offerings in terms of dollars and cents, only until we give you all that we are, can that be the rightful offering? Take these gifts and use it to the upbuilding of your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen. The theme of today is outreach, and there's really not any other scripture that I can be drawn to other than this one, talking about outreach. A little bit later, you'll probably hear some familiar stories. Maybe they're worth hearing again, though. But this scripture comes from Mark, the second chapter, and the first five verses, Mark 2, 1 through 5. Now, a few days later, when Jesus again entered Capernaum, the people heard that he had come. They gathered in such large numbers that there was no room left. That would be a good problem, wouldn't it? Not even outside the door. And he preached the word to them. Now, some men came, bringing to him a paralyzed man, carried by four of them. And since they could not get him to Jesus because of the crowd, they made an opening in the roof above Jesus by digging through it and then lowering the mat the man was lying on. Now, when Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralyzed man, "Son, your sins are forgiven." May God add his richest blessing to the reading of his word, the word of God, for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Man, I love that choir. You can write this down and I'll be glad to sign it. We're fixing to pour a lot of support and help and energy to make this choir, I don't know if it can be any better than that, but to support this choir and this service. I spoke at a really big youth rally in North Alabama. And don't get me wrong, the praise band was good. I mean, how can you mess up the truth, you know? But it was good. And they played for an hour and a half. But nothing like that. Give me that any day. I mean, they were great, but that's fantastic. And Trish is my good friend. She's up there. Thank you, Trish. That's awesome. Well, a little bit about Matthew and I. You'll be hearing some more stuff about it. But before I get into the message today, one thing I think you would want to know is Matthew was nice enough to allow me to be at both services these first 2 weeks, because there's some things we'd like to talk about, and one of them is going to be today. But starting in March, I will be doing the Arbor on first and third Sundays. Matthew will be in Green Street first and third, and then the second and fourth, he will be in the Arbor, and I will be in Green Street. So, you know, we'll be swapping it all around, and we're excited about that and can't wait. But let's get on with the message today, because this is it's exciting. I usually read my scripture just before I do the message. So what I would like to ask you to do real briefly is just say a short silent prayer that everything I say, everything we think, would be to glorify Christ. Let's pray. Amen. Thank you. You know, when I was a principal in high school, I just could not teach a class. I love teenagers. I'm weird. Put me in a room with 100 teenagers and lock the door, I think I'm in heaven. I think you might think you're in the other place, but not me. I love that. And I tried. I went to college thinking I would teach classes that I could. I mean, don't tell the Freedom from Religion people that I could sort of preach in class a little bit, you know. And so I taught sociology. And I put as many kids as I could get into that room, and we'd have great discussions. I loved it. But we always had a little difference of opinion. It was kind of funny. They loved, back in those days, the movie, the show Friends was very popular. And they loved Friends. Me, not so much. And so we would have an argument, you know, about what is a real friend? That's not friendship. And they'd say, well, Coach, what are you talking about? But it was all in fun. No matter what side you're on that debate, you got to admit it's a good title. Friends is one of the great words that we have today. And I'm very blessed and fortunate to learn what that meant early in my life. I was an only child. And my parents, two best couple friends they had no children. So I was triple spoiled. There was no doubt about it. But it was Alan E. and Minter and Irene. Alan E., we'd go on vacations with and have a big time. Al was the ultimate gardener. He'd go to our farm. He had a great garden. I'd go slip down the creek and fish while he was doing all the work. So it worked out real well. Minter and Irene, Minter was our hunting buddy, and we would all go quail hunting together. Irene made a great Grecian orange cake. I was so blessed to understand friendship really early in my life. When I went to college and decided that I would play tennis at Auburn, I met the number one player from Homewood High School that I'd never really known before. His name was Reg Harris. And it didn't take us long to find out that we would be great friends. Now, those friends you don't hardly see. You know, you go years and years without seeing them, but when you do, it's just like it was when you last met them. When my father passed away, I hadn't seen Reggie in years. But there he was, you know, in the cemetery when I needed him. When his mom passed away, I was there for him. So I had an understanding there of what great friendships are. I just told you about how our family feels about you and the opportunity for me to share in a ministry to great friends is an unbelievable blessing. Now, I've heard it said before that if you got five fantastic friends in your lifetime, you're lucky. And I would say to you, whoever said that wasn't a Christian. Because we have friendships through Christ, and there's lots of them. I just did a message to the children down there. I'm going to do it with them too. I took a piece of paper and I tore it, and I said, that stands for your life. How easy it is to tear our lives when we stand alone. But then I got a book. Had about 300 pages in it. And all those pages were together. That's all of us together. And then it was bound around, you know, how books are. That's Christ, who takes all our individual lives and makes one out of it. That's not a bunch of pages. That's one book. And I said, now tear that. Even Matthew couldn't tear it. I got Matthew up there. I said, let's get the strongest guy we know. He couldn't tear it either. That's the power of friendship through Christ in the church. Jesus said in the upper room, tonight you're not disciples. Tonight you are my friends. No greater love have one man for another than he lay down his life for his friends. David and Jonathan comes to mind. I mean, friendship is powerful in the Bible. Now, the scripture that I just read, it really doesn't say that these four guys were friends of the paralyzed man. But it doesn't say they weren't friends either. And I would say to you that it's very possible that the four guys in our scripture that bring this paralyzed man to Jesus were friends of his. We're going to say that that's the case. They passed by their friend on the side of the road, maybe. That's where most of the beggars and the blind were there. And they made a decision that they were going to take this man to Jesus. This was no easy task. I mean, you don't pull your pickup truck down there and load him up and drive him on up to the house. They got a mat and picked dead weight up off that mat with the four corners and walked him to the house. When they got there, it was packed. They couldn't get in. Well, I'd like for the church, our church, to be like that. You know, that kind of gets me excited. But not to give up, they went on top of the roof, and it gets real hilarious. Usually when they went to Capernaum, they went to Peter's mother-in-law's house. This happened probably in Peter's mother-in-law's house. My mother-in-law's here today. I am not tearing the roof off her house. But here it's Peter sitting in a hole big enough to lower a man on a mat. This is not a little hole. This is huge. And they lowered down in front of Jesus. A big dirt clod hits the man in front on his head. He looks up. And Jesus looks at that man and says, your sins are forgiven. Now, there's more to that story, isn't there? I mean, there's a bunch of scribes and Pharisees in there. They're always there, right? And they're saying, well, how can he do that? The story actually ends where Jesus kind of shows him and says, okay, take up your bed and walk then. The man takes up his bed and walks out of that house healed. And that's a great story. We'll do that some other time. Today, we want to focus not on the man who's healed, but the four men who got him there. Because that's what we want to look at outreach. They got some qualities in their life that I desperately need in mine. For one thing, they have a sense of urgency there in their life. Now, I'm sorry, you're going to get some Andy Griffin in here, okay? I almost know the dialogue of it as well as the Bible, I'm ashamed to say. But I'm thinking of the episode where Mr. Dave, Buddy Ebsen with Beverly Hillbillies, he's kind of a bum that comes to Mayberry, but Opie falls in love with him. Andy can't put him in jail because Opie loves him so much, so he sends Mr. Dave to trim the shrubbery at the Taylor house. So this setting's got Opie and Mr. Dave sitting on the porch. They're trying to decide what kind of motif they're going to use, and when they finally figure that out, Mr. Dave looks at Opie and says, we'll do it first thing tomorrow. It's 8 o'clock in the morning. Opie says, tomorrow? Mr. Dave says, yeah, tomorrow. The perfect time to do any job tomorrow. Well, there's absolutely nothing you can't do tomorrow. With that, he walks off. pulls out his golly wobbler fishing lure and walks toward the local lake, leaving a pretty confused little Opie sitting on the steps. Aren't you glad that the four guys didn't go up to the man that was paralyzed and said, we'll get you tomorrow. We'll pick you up tomorrow. It's pretty crowded up there. Yeah, we'll get you tomorrow, the perfect time to bring anyone to Christ tomorrow. There's absolutely nothing you can't do tomorrow. That's not what they said. They said, we'll do it today. Right now, right this second, we're going to bring you into the presence of Christ. If somebody looked at me and said, and had a bottle of pills and said, Billy, have you heard? If you take this pill right here, it cures cancer within an hour. If they gave me that, I might finish this message. But as soon as I did, I would run out that door. I'd let Matthew tell everybody goodbye. And I'd hop in my truck. And I would break every speed limit I could. And Dave, they might get me too. But I would speed to the houses of people that I know had cancer. And I'd get up there to the house. And if it was locked, I'd kick the door in. And I'd go in and I'd find them. And I'd say, hey, have you heard? If you take this pill, it will cure your cancer within an hour. Take it. Here's your water. Take it right now. We've got something a whole lot better than a pill that cures cancer. We've got Jesus Christ who transforms lives, who changes darkness into light, death into life, who gives us direction in our life, helps us overpower the obstacles of our life. We have that to offer our friend. And I would say to you, where's the urgency? Do we have the same urgency to bring our friend to Christ as we would if we had a cure for cancer? And it applies to all of us. Something else I love about these guys is they're selfless. You don't hear that word much anymore. Selfless. I had the honor and privilege to speak at Bill Stewart's funeral Friday. I think he was a great man. What stands out to me more than anything else is he was a selfless man. He was always putting others first, always thinking of other people. That's beautiful. It's about time for Bobby Loudermilk and I to start spending some time together. See, I'm over the class reunions, and our 50th, don't tell anybody. I graduated when I was 10, I'm going to tell you. Our 50th class reunion is coming up, and we're planning it. And Bobby is always an integral part. Love the Bobby Loudermilks of the world. He does all the work, and I get all the thanks. I mean, you can't beat that. But on our 25th reunion, we're driving down the road. We grew up side by side. We were great friends, played in the woods, built forts, Burke. You know, in the woods and stuff, played war and all that stuff. But as we went to high school, as it happens, we kind of separated a little bit. See, I had to be in everything in high school. I had to play every sport offered, be in every organization. I was always that kind of person in high school. Bobby, no, not so much. So as we drove down planning our 25th reunion, he began to share his story. Mom finally left. She couldn't take Dad's drinking anymore. So that left Mary and I, Mary was his sister, to run the broom factory. So every day, we would go to the broom factory at 5:30, 6 o'clock, and we'd work until we walked to school. And when school was over, we would go back and work in the broom factory till 8 or 8:30, trying to earn money for the family. I remember when we couldn't pay our rent, and we had to move into a house, we had no electricity. It got cold, so cold that there was frost on inside the windows. I remember waking up one time with a blanket sleeping on the floor, and there was a rat sitting up on top of the blanket where my foot was. And as he began to tell his story, I only had one question. Where was I? Where was I at? Supposedly his best friend growing up. Oh yeah, I was so busy doing my stuff and being occupied with myself that I didn't have time to be there for my friend. These four men, they had their own agendas with Jesus. Don't you think? They had things they wanted Christ to do in their life, but they put those aside so that they could bring this man to Christ. I tell you, they were selfless. I've coached a lot of good guys. I've coached some great players in my lifetime. But by far, the player that I love to coach the most is the guy that stands on the sideline, never gets to play, and cheers for the guy playing his position. That's my guy. That's why I coach. He goes home and eats dinner, and his daddy says, "Coach don't ever play you, son. Why don't you just quit?" He comes to school on Monday, and his friends run up to him and say, "Wait, we were at the game. You didn't even get in there. What's going on with that?" But he doesn't quit. He stays. Why? Because he puts the team first. He's all about the team. Now, I would stand at the door after every game, win, lose, or draw, and I would shake the hands of every player, hug their neck, and tell them that I love them. But when that guy came, Dwight knows what I'm talking about. When that guy comes up there that didn't get to play that night, and he didn't play because of me. I'm the reason he didn't play. And I shook his hand and hugged his neck and told him that I loved him, and he told me that as he walked off. I said to myself, that's why I coach. That right there is my coach. Because we need that guy. He's going to marry a wife one day, put her first, have kids, put them first, join a church, put the church first. He's going to live in this country and put the country first because he's selfless. So these guys teach me a lesson that I need to know about selflessness in my life. And finally, and I'll close with this, they found a way. They found a way. It was a weird way. It was a crazy way. Not sure I would have done it. But they found a way to get their friend in front of Jesus. Now, you've probably heard this before. But we have pets and then we have great pets, you know? Our greatest pet, and I've got witnesses, Ryan will testify to this too, was Marty. Marty was a little Cocker Spaniel. And we loved Marty. And on the Coleman totem pole, Marty was way up there ahead of me, for sure. Ask Sharon, she'll tell you. You know, Marty was smarter than me. He was more loving than me. And I love Marty, too. He went with me everywhere that I went. Marty was with me. One cold day, I went out to run. Real cold. Marty wasn't with me. But Shereen had always told me Marty was smarter, so I figured Marty was in a warm spot while I was running in the cold weather. I finished and I come back. It was just by accident that I looked to my right and I saw out in the lake Marty. We had a pond in front of our house. Marty was out there. Well, she was a Cocker Spaniel, right? What's the big deal? The big deal was that the pond was iced over and she had fallen in and couldn't get out. The only way that she could support herself is she had her chin up on top of the ice that was keeping her afloat. And I went crazy nuts. I ran down about 50 yards down. The boat was down there. I ran down there to get the boat, and it was in the ice, and I was jerking and pulling. And that particular day, I was a lot stronger than I should have been. And I pulled it out, and I started running down the yard with a boat in my hand and a paddle in the other hand, hollering at Marty, "Marty, Marty, I'm coming, here I come." And I went down there, and of course, the lake was frozen down there, too. So I had to take the boat, and I got in it, and I started busting ice, and little by little, started up. One time, Marty went under. I said, "Marty, Marty," and she came back up and put it back on there. She was getting really tired. I was getting closer and closer, and finally I reached out, and Marty put her head on the paddle. I said, "Okay, all right, I think we can do this." I keep fighting and getting closer. Finally, I reach out and I grab her. I put her in the boat, and she just sinks. I said, "Oh, now I got to get back," right, all the broken ice. I'm getting back, and I'm fighting through there, and I finally get her, and I grab her, and I run around the house. About the time our neighbor pulls up, Greg lived about half a mile from us. He said, "What's going on, man? I heard you hollering and stuff." I said, "Marty's about to freeze to death. I got to take you in." I go in. I put her by a heater. I called Dr. Lee, our vet. I said, "What do I do?" He said, give her something warm to drink. So I went in there, and I warmed up the ketchup and the mustard and the milk and everything I could. I had like seven bowls sitting in front of
brother. And yeah, I promise you, this is true. I don't like this. I just waited to see. Well, about 30 minutes later, Marty started drinking that warm milk. She actually got okay. I was about as tired telling it as I was doing it, but she was going to make it. She was okay. So here's the thing. Marty died one day, but it wasn't going to be that day. No. Not on my watch it was. And I would have jumped in there and gotten her. And then we both would have probably perished, but you're saying, well, what's the point? That's a good story, but what are you talking about here? Well, what I'm talking about is that was a Friday, and on Saturday I'm driving up to Sand Mountain, and I'm doing a men's prayer breakfast, and I'm trying to figure out what I want to say, you know? And I pull over to the side, and God does what he does so often when you're trying to figure out what you want to say. He says what he wants to say. And what he said that day was, Billy, you know what? If you had as much passion bringing others to Christ as you do saving your little dog, I think I could use you. God's always right, you know. It was challenging. We have the opportunity, like these four guys did, to bring our friends into the presence of Christ. The friends didn't do anything. They didn't perform a miracle. They didn't preach a message or give a devotional. They simply brought their friend into the presence of Jesus. And that's what we are called to do. Let's pray. Father God, we praise you today for those opportunities. And I would like to ask your forgiveness of the many opportunities that I said I could do tomorrow. I need the selflessness. I need the urgency in my life to truly do what you've called me and all of us to do. So we thank you for that opportunity. And we pray that as we begin this endeavor, that this will be foremost on our mind, just to bring our friends into your presence. Forgive us of our sins. In Jesus' name, amen. We have a closing hymn of 569. Mm-hmm. Let me take this opportunity to come here just to say, as through the years, this is an open offer. Always open. I always spend a few seconds thanking God for the opportunity to share. But then I'll be down here if you need me. Actually, if you go pray, you don't need me. All you need is God. He'll take care of that. But let's all stand together to sing this song.
569.
Story of peace and love.
Dear Father God, we're so thankful for this opportunity to worship you. And may everything we do say and think, the way we live our life, and the way that we come to the side of our friend, all be to your glory. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Have a seat. Say it's